Hey, what's up, guys? Dan Dix here from Press for Truth. Today is Wednesday, December 28, 2011, and I hope you all had a great Christmas and enjoyed your holidays with friends and family. I certainly did. And I just got back into town last night, and I'm more than ready to get right back into the swing of things here at Press for Truth. Now, as some of you may already be aware, starting in 5 days from now, we are going to be officially launching pressfortruth.tv, where we're going to be coming at you every day, Monday to Friday, with daily videos. So we're really hoping that you guys will support Press for Truth and support independent media by signing up to pressfortruth.tv, and I certainly hope to see you there this Monday. But as for today, we wanted to update you about the press conference that we covered just last week, where two Canadians are taking on their case against the Bank of Canada in an effort to restore it back to the way it was prior to 1974, before we began borrowing from the Bank of International Settlements and the International Monetary Fund. So we wanted to show you our coverage of that press conference today, mainly because there's been such a lack from the mainstream media on this. There's pretty much been no mention of it whatsoever. In fact, the only people who were there at the press conference were independent media. We had Lawrence McCurry, independent freelance journalist based here in Toronto. We had Brendan from We Are Change Toronto at wearechangetoronto.org. And of course, Terry Wilson from Canadian Awareness Network was there. And myself and Steve from Press for Truth were there to provide our coverage. So we'll leave you with that today, some footage of our coverage from that press conference. And once again, I hope to see you on Monday over at pressfortruth.tv.
My name is Rocco Galati. Seated to my immediate left is Ann Emmett, and to her immediate left is Mr. William Krem. And they're two of the co-plaintiffs in an action that they filed as plaintiffs along with Comer, the Committee on Monetary and Economic Reform, against the Minister of Finance and the Bank of Canada. It challenges the abdication of sovereignty and governance in handing over monetary, financial, and socioeconomic policy through finances to foreign private entities, and a refusal to abide by and implement the terms of Bank of Canada Act with respect to loans, with respect to human capital spending, such as hospital, health, education, and so forth. The second aspect of the challenge constitutionally challenges the government's refusal to publish and set out the actual revenues that are collected or collectible before the transfer back of tax credits, before net revenue is calculated and announced every year. The effect of this is that MPs in Parliament, Canadians in general, are completely left in the dark about the actual revenues Canada collects every year before the transfer credits go back, with the consequence that no real debate can be had on whether in any particular year a deficit is necessary, and if it's necessary, where the money or loans should come from. This is a constitutional violation that goes to the foundation of our system in terms of the rule of law.
The Bank of Canada was actually organized as a private bank, and it was nationalized only in the year before the outbreak of the war. And by doing so, Canada's record, economic record, the cost of the war to it, far more successful than that of the United States or Britain, who had private central banks.
You understand that because the Bank of Canada belongs to us, and we earned that as a result of the consciousness and concern that arose in Canadian people at the time of the Great Depression that Bill was talking about a minute ago. And so here the government is able to create money that we need for schools, for hospitals, for healthcare, for the environment, at little or no interest. And it's borrowing it instead from private banks who create that money out of thin air. It's nothing but debt. It's nothing but numbers in a computer. after we allow them to make money out of thin air, we allow them to collect interest at our expense on the money they lend, then when they do get into difficulties, which they do because we've granted them deregulation that they require, then we are told that we have a deficit. And that is, we must pay off the debt. We must pay off the deficit at the expense of education, healthcare, and all the rest of it. How clever is this? It's time to challenge that system.
Our government does not have the constitutional jurisdiction to govern at the behest of foreign private entities, banking or otherwise.
The Bank of Canada, in fact, also fully bankrolled the Second World War.
And the St. Lawrence Seaway.
And the St. Lawrence, and so on. And so for the government to pretend that this is new, this is a crazy new idea, it's just a fallacy. That's why the bank was set up in the first place, so we would have, as Canadians, control over our own monetary policy as it affects our socioeconomic policies.
Between 1981 and 1995, the federal government collected from income tax something like $619.2 billion. It paid in interest to private moneylenders $428.2 billion.
You can't allow a foreign private entities in secret meetings to govern your country. And that's what's happening with respect to the way banking exerts its influence, because they're ignoring the Bank of Canada, and moreover, they're ignoring their constitutional duty to properly account in the budgetary process.
During the time of the G20 infamous meeting down in Toronto, there was a seminar downtown at which Paul Martin, you will remember, as finance minister and prime minister of this country, Paul Martin was the keynote speaker, and this was his message. Nation states can no longer handle their own economies. There must be international laws, and those laws must be mandatory and enforceable. What we must have is global economic governance. Now, I think that we are at a defining moment in history, and I think that democracy is in deep, deep trouble. But I really think that we are at a great watershed, and we will either make the right choices and challenge this dysfunctional, obsolete, wasteful, destructive economic system that depends on exploitation, on growth, on destruction, or we, I think, are at the edge of a very dark period. That is my motivation for doing whatever I can to bring to the attention of the Canadian people this option and the threat that they face.